it on? It should be live now. Refresh your...
Say hello to the viewers.
Are
we ready to start?
Oh, cool.
Evening, viewers.
Not getting the same picture.
No, it'll be a couple of seconds behind. Yeah. Thank you everybody for coming today. Matthias reached out to us through Facebook, and after some toing and froing, he offered to come and do a demonstration for us of his wood turning, of which that's his career. So hopefully we'll all learn something tonight, Matthias. Thank you for you, and thank you viewers on the internet. I'm over here, mate.
Yeah, back on the star, please stop.
Alright, so I'll hand over to you there, mate, and thank you for coming along. Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Go.
Okay. I'm Matthias Beer. My last name, Beer. coming from Switzerland, and I have here my two little helpers, so we need that. And I'm a professional woodturner, so that means I graduated in woodturning 33 years ago. No, I began with an apprenticeship 33 years ago. Apprenticeship in Switzerland, that means a dual system with school and working in a guest company. Wood turning lasts 4 years, 1 day school, the rest of the week in the company. That's what usually two-thirds of Swiss school leavers does, an apprenticeship. Whatever you want, you can do that in Switzerland. Switzerland, you know, it's a very small country. It's about two-thirds of Tasmania, with 9 million of residents. 7 million in the north are speaking German. Then we have the west, 2 million about French-speaking, and in the south, 300,000 Italian-speaking. We are coming from the north, from the German-speaking part, but living now in the Italian-speaking part since 27 years. The Italian-speaking part means it's really separated not only by the language, it's also separated by the Alps. A chain of 3,000 or more meters high mountains. So we are really separated of the rest of Switzerland, not only by the language, but really separated. There's two possibilities to come to us: a tunnel with the car, 16 kilometers, or a tunnel with the train, 57 keys. This one is new. I never made it, but that's these are the two possibilities to come from the German part to the Italian part. This separation means also that I'm the only graduated wood turner in the Italian part. So for many years I was separated from every wood turning input to. And only with Facebook, I had input not only from the German part, but from the whole world, and that's very a nice thing. What I would like to show you today, that's end grain hollowing. End grain hollowing because everybody knows doing a ball in cross grain. That's well known. You can see that on Facebook, on YouTube. That's a very well known. But doing the same thing in the end grain, it's much more difficult, and there is some technique, not very well known but very interesting, so I'd like to show you that. The first one is back hollowing. I don't know if you have seen perhaps some video. Back hollowing, for me, that's the most difficult kind. But I love it very much. It works very well for small diameters, for egg cups, or also for a little bit bigger stuff like 80 millimeters of diameter like this. Bigger, you can do that, but it's very hard. I'll show you why. This is technique you should never use in cross grain. Not a good idea. I think if you don't have questions, I begin.
Please
do.
Okay. It's called back hollowing because you're using your gouge here and not like usual here. But before beginning, I don't know what's the wood. Because it's, I think it's an Australian wood, I don't know. But, black wood?
Black wood.
Okay. Never used, so I have an excuse if something does not work.
Okay.
Put on glasses, and as usual, before turn on the lathe, a quick control, and then we can roughing this one, or with the roughing gouge, you know that. For this little diameters, I usually use the skew. I know it's not very it's a little bit hated of a lot of people, the skew. I love it very much because it gives really a smooth finish. Okay. Now, well, before beginning to just a straight cut. Most important thing using the skew is not only the skew, but especially is the bevel. If you rub every time very well the bevel, you don't have problems with the skew. And that's the same thing if you're doing a straight cut in the end grain. If the bevel is always rubbing, that's an easy job. Okay. Back hollowing. For back hollowing, I prefer using, or you can do that with the spindle gouge. If it's not too aggressive, if it has a very long bevel, it does not work very well, because we're working on the inside and we have to rub the bevel too, and if it's this very long, it doesn't touch very well. You can see that after. You can do that also with a small bowl gouge, and this one is my preferred. I have a double, I don't know, you can see that, you can show that. It's a double bevel that works very well in back hollowing, but it works also very well if you are doing a bowl, because you have always this point where you are losing the bevel when you change direction. And if you have this double bevel, you have a little bit of bevel here and a little bit of bevel in the other direction, and so you don't lose the bevel so easily. Now, I have to have a look at my... Okay. We are beginning to... with the tip in the center and with the bevel rubbing the wood, the end grain. And then we have to push in this direction 1 or 2 o'clock, and at the same time we have to turn slightly the gouge to the right. So I just do a cut. So rubbing the bevel, then pushing slightly, if we are working in this direction, we are always cutting the wood. We are not scraping. And that's the most important thing. If you are scraping the end grain, if you are scraping generally, you don't have a smooth finish. In the end grain, that's worth. You have a very open grain. If you are cutting the end grain, and the only solution to cut the end grain is this one, you have always a smooth finish. And that's, you can see that here, that's when you are cutting. When you are scraping, you don't have
this kind of shavings. Okay, now I'm using this one because I prefer this one, but point you are deep, and at a certain point you are risking to lose the bevel, and you are using the rim of this egg cup to as a fulcrum. Not only the bevel but also the rim is only every time in contact. So if you are doing it like that, you are risking to catch in with the tip. So you can feel it. It's warm, but that's okay. Yeah, we can have a look again to the shavings. That's a shaving of a cut, and also the finish, you can, I don't know if you can see that, yeah, it's a very smooth finish. It's not finished yet, but it's very smooth. If you're doing the same thing, just you can just do that. I think you can see the difference. Yeah, you can see that, especially here. That's another kind of finish. Okay. It's very important not doing the finish outside before finishing the inside, because using the rim, there is a high pressure, and if you are you have finished the outside, you're risking to break it. Now, in this movement, you can see that now, what I meant before, if I'm using the gouge, it touches in on the tip and it touches here, and if you have a very long bevel, the distance of the two points is very long, and you're risking to catch it in. With the double bevel, you can see that very good. I think you have more contact, yes, that's what I was looking for. You have more contact and less risk to catching in. So I love very much this double bevel here. Okay. For egg cups, I'm doing internal diameter of 43, I don't know the axe in Australia, but then template, yes, for the death, just a little bit. You can work in both directions, but you are beginning to try the back hollowing. I would try it only from the center to the outside, and later, after made a lot of practice, you can try it also in the other direction. Now, I think the most difficult point is the center, but because sometimes in the center you have a little bit a point, but that's fine like this, I think. Well, now we can do the outside. Just doing something. I'm not here for the nice shape. That's just a quick job without sanding. Yeah. That's back hollowing. Yeah. Any question about?
What's the length of your double, or the first part of your double bevel? What comes on with those?
You mean the length of the whole bevel, or
the
first part?
Yeah,
the second part is very short. So yeah. The second part about 2 millimeters.
So why that length? I've found it's basically the opposite way around.
I use more often the bowl gouge for bowls.
Yeah.
So I need the longer bevel. I just need a small second bevel. I don't need a long second bevel.
Smaller holes.
Yeah.
Your two bevels blended together.
I can pass you this. It's just I am sharpening with a cheek, especially the ball gouges. I'm using a cheek. I'm using the Nova cheek, and when I finish sharpening, I just change the angle. I'm doing just a quick touch also for the second panel. Okay. Well, you can see that also on the tool. Other questions?
Did you like the language?
It's hard, but I like hardwood, so yes, I do. Yep. Without M. No, it's nice to turn, and I'm just doing another one, so quick. If you have more questions, please, I would like to answer all I can. Works also without the double barrel, eh? But it's
easier with the double barrel.
I don't know if you have seen just now the vibration. That's because there is no double barrel. Because it's very aggressive, so it hits a little bit. And the bevel, I'm telling you always screw up the bevel, but it's very important to just, I love very much what Mike Wald says. Mike Wald says, just let the bevel kiss the wood. You don't have to press the bevel on the wood, but you have to just slowly, If you're losing the contact of the barrel, it's gone. It also with the cutting tool. But the last touch I prefer. If you're confronting the first one with this one, also the parting tool is scraping, so you can confront the fit of the ball of both, and you can see the difference. Just now, to not throw away a piece of black wood. Did this one. So I bring home a small piece of black wood. Always rubbing the battery, always. Okay. It's just to not throw away a piece of black wood. And if I can, I would like to bring that home. Sure. So I'm bringing home a piece of Australian black. Yeah. It depends a little bit of the diameter. For small diameters like these egg cups, 5 centimeters or something like this, you can do, I think, about 1.5 of the diameter. But if you do something like 8, you would have a very high overhang. And so it doesn't work 1.5. Perhaps only maximum like the diameter or less.
So can you do different soft wood than hardwood
Yes, because it hurts a little bit less.
Yeah.
But
if you have a lot of overhead, so yeah, you could try something like this. Yeah, that works. So you have more. Also, with an overhang of 10 centimeters, it works a little bit.
Other questions? Okay. So,
I brought a second. I brought another tool to make the same job. Ant grain hollowing. This is a hook. A tool of the German tradition, also French tradition, but in the English wood turning tradition doesn't exist the hook. It exists also in the Japanese wood turning tradition, but they are using it in another kind. So it's a little bit another story. I have two kinds. This is a straight hook, and this is the cranked hook. The difference is if you are working in the ant grain with the cranked hook, here in the middle, it's very hard to work, especially if you are in too deep. So you have to cut, but it doesn't work. Here it works, but in the depth, no, not. But here it cuts better than you have a 45-degree cut inside always, but I'm showing that outside. And with this one, you have a 90-degree cut. So this one gives a smoother finish. Well, to show you that, I would like to do a small goblet with this piece. I need Hank.
What's the manufacturer of knives?
Sorry?
What's the manufacturer of knives?
It's a German. A German manufacturing. Nine? The name Wiedemann. Wiedemann. There is also a very nice, very well made video. On the homepage, I can let you the link.
Can you do a captive ring on the goblet? Can you do a captive ring on the end of the goblet?
I can't try that, yes.
I thought a few things might be interesting.
But I have to say, I've never done that.
Have you captive?
No. So,
I don't know if I have the good
Your wood skills are.
I can try something.
Here he comes.
I won't use the skill too rough. it's a little bit too much. No skill this time. I can control in that, speed down.
We have to prepare the jump tunnel. The chuck tenant. I would like to do a straight cut also here. The straight cut, I always prefer this cue. You have to pay attention to not cutting also the center. Okay, that's enough. And now we are using the chuck to fix our piece again. Again. There's some questions. Do we have time?
Yeah, your working day, how many hours are you turning? What are you manufacturing to generate money?
I'm generating more money teaching than manufacturing stuff. Yeah, I'm working for half a day every day, I think. The rest is preparing and band, so I have also my own small sawmill, so I'm preparing all the blanks, all the wood I've been using, or nearly all the wood, preparing by myself with wood growing around in the zone. So this is also a part. I have also a kiln where I'm drying all my stuff. So half of the time is turning, and the other half is preparing and so on. But a lot of time is also teaching. I have a wood shop with 6 lathe for the groups.
What sort of wood do you mainly use?
Sorry?
What sort of wood do you use?
Oh, I love very much the fruit woods, or cherry, pear. I'm using walnut, maple, whatever they bring me. Yeah, I had a photo a few days ago. I'm sharing my wood shop with two other guys. One is a joiner, the third one is a wood artist, and they sent me a photo of a lot of apple wood in front of my shop. So during my holidays, someone brought me some wood. Very nice, yeah, and apple is great wood. But you have to know also another thing. There was 5 centimeters of snow over my wood, so that's my wood.
Okay, thank you.
No worries.
Bigger stuff I would use in the beginning the center point, but it's okay. Okay, now same thing, a straight cut in the head, in the hand crane. I told you I love this girl. To use the hook, we need a hole to begin. This hole we can do with a Forstner or something, but I'll just do it with a gouge, scraping, but it's not our finish, so we can do that. Before that, I'm doing that. For the moment, that's enough. Now, trying the hook. For the hook, the tool rest has to be a little bit distant. That's because if it's too near, this step here is a little bit boring. With the tool hook, we are always working slightly downhill, and we are working with the cutting on the center. So I have to. Like this. The bevel does always touch the wood. That's very important. If you are not rubbing the bevel, you're hooking in and you're moving this piece away. Well, you're well protected. That is another thing very important. But it's not only for the hook tool, but if you have the handle straight on the body, you're working better. You have a better tool control. That's it. But it's very important with the hook. So we're rubbing the bevel, turn slightly to the left, and then it begins to cut. And it is cutting. That's very important. Can do very small shavings, and if you are turning a little bit more to the left, you got bigger shavings, but it's also shattering a little bit. You can see that very well. It is cutting. This cutting, and if you are turning more or less, got bigger or smaller shading. You're always working only from the inside to the outside. With this one, you should not working in the other side, in the other direction, and also with this one, also only, absolutely only end grain, no cross grain. Okay, here in this depth, you can use. You can use the crank tool also for the bottom, but you have to work like this, and at a certain point it doesn't work anymore, so you can use the straight hook or you can use a scraper. That's I would like to go more
that or deep.
So
it's
dark.
Yeah.
Dark inside. Okay. Oh, that's cool, yeah. Always wrap the barrel, turn slightly to the left, and then it cuts. Barrel is rubbing, and it is cut. Just a little point in the middle. I have to eliminate it. Move that so you can see better. Okay. You can see here this, and you heard it before, it was shattering a little bit, and you see that that's because the wood is quite hard. but you can see on the side this very, very smooth cutting. It could be better, but there is a little bit a wave in, but yeah. Question about hook?
Do you sharpen the hooks?
Yes. The hook is not really easy to sharpen, but you sharpen it not on the outside, but on the inside. And I'm using this CBN tip, but you can also use a file. But it must be sharpened in the inside. Sometimes when I'm a little bit too lazy, because I have I'm putting this one on another lathe, and then I remove the tip and I'm sharpening like this. It doesn't work the tool in the hand, and so sometimes I'm too lazy, and I'm sharpening slightly on the outside with a stone. But you have to pay attention, because if it is round on the cutting part, you have to turn too much, you're losing the barrel.
So it's not really a good idea, but sometimes we are doing this, these things, but they are, that's my challenge.
A diamond
tip, or what is it? CBM is not really diamond, but something like diamond. Not so hard like diamond, but something harder than this this white, or harder than this white. I'm giving you also the but this is the straight hook. With the straight hook you can work very well also on the bottom, because it's cutting here, so you can enter straight and it is cutting.
Yeah.
But it's harder to control this one, because if you are moving it a little bit too much, it hooks in easily. This one is easier to control. Yeah. Other questions? I'm going to finish the outside. Ah, it could be better.
To rest behind you.
To rest, yeah. Thanks. Okay, someone asked me to do a captain ring. I never done that before, but I can try that. Right. I really never made that. Huh? It's not. It's cool.
There is an extra tool. It makes it a lot easier. Really a ring inside, it is a little bit like this, but it's kept. Cutting the goblet with the skewer, you can do a very nice uncut, so it stands very well. Inside is not how I love.
Not perfect.
That it's not perfect, but yeah, it's okay. Okay. Oh yeah, I don't know. It's venomous or.
Beautiful.
So it's the cup for life. No, for the mother-in-law.
Make sure that one comes back. It's
going straight to the pool room, that one.
Okay, any more questions? Not only about what I showed you. It hooks immediately, and I tried that once. It broke a little thing. Yes, it. Where is the hook?
Okay.
Yeah, it broke.
Oh,
really? Yeah. Fortunately, it's only the tip. You can change the tip.
Yeah. You buy them locally or you buy them on internet?
Sorry?
Locally or you buy them on internet?
You can buy them on the internet. Yeah, there is this Wiedemann, the producer. You can buy them directly with him. But if you want to do an order, you can do that also. It doesn't change the price. Yeah. But I'm not here to sell. but I have also a front shop. That's because where in the Italian part of Switzerland there is nothing about wood turning, and my students always were asking me, where can I buy, where can I find, what should I buy, and so on. And at a certain point I said, so, I'm doing that. Yeah, it's not a big business because it's a small part of Switzerland, so but it's a service to my students. So if you want to buy that with me, you can. It's a very interesting tool, really. But you have to make practice, and it's better beginning with small pieces with six centimeters or something like this, and then if you think you're moving well and you're controlling well the tool, you can go into bigger diameters and also to deeper. Yes, so it's especially for deep and opening hollowing jobs. It's very nice. Not for undercutted hollowings. The straight hook, it works very well also for undercutted hollowing jobs, but not for very undercutted stuff.
So would the straight hook be better for going down the wall of the vessel?
No, the crank hook is better for the wall.
Yes.
The straight hook is better for the bottom.
Or which one of the two for getting the excess out in the first place? Either one?
I did not understand.
To get the rough wood out, which one then? The hook is best to go down the wall.
I'm using 90% I'm using the crank hook, and very often I'm too lazy to change the hook, and so for the bottom I'm using the gouge. If you're doing a box inside squared, it's better using the straight hook.
Yeah, yeah.
But if you're doing something a little bit open or a lot open, you're using the crank hook. There's also the big, this one is the small edition. There is also the big edition, it's a little bit bigger, but I'm also for big stuff, I'm using always the small one, I prefer it. The big one is very aggressive, so
sometimes
really
you don't need to cut so much.
I made with this one. I made if you go on my Facebook page, I made.
Did you read it?
No. Uh, 68 centimeters end grade ball in U. U is very hard, and I made it all with this one, all with the hook. It was very, not very deep, 10 centimeters of depth, but very large, and I made it all with the small cranked hook. This one was it was not easy. It was hard. I had a 10 for a lot of weeks after. Yeah, you have to. Yeah, it was hard. It was hurting everywhere here because you have to. Yes, but I made it all with the hook, and I tried it also only for roughing with the gouge, but it was hard. I prefer doing the whole job with the hook. Yeah.
With your students, how long a period do you have them?
I'm doing a lot of introducing courses, 2 days, and a lot of these are turning back once a month or every 2 months for half a day, and then the introducing course is for 6 persons. But when they turn back, usually they turn back alone or in two, and they are concentrating on one argument, and we are working for that, and then they have their home work to do. Usually they are showing me all the things on Facebook after. And it works like this. It's not the structure.
We're not turning out professional.
No.
It's not regimented.
No. They are not finishing with a diploma or something. No.
They're just finishing with a nice piece of work.
Yeah. Hopefully. Or with a broken nose. No, very often who comes for the first 2 days has not life at home, and it, after this they are deciding if continuing, and then they are buying a life.
Time? I don't know.
Are we... 9 o'clock. They're willing to listen as long as you're willing to talk, I guess.
I can tell you all. Yeah. I can speaking about wood turning for 24 hours.
I've got to bring me a pillow.
No, that's fantastic.
Well, I hope you have enjoyed that and learned some things.
Fantastic. Thank you very much.
Before you go, thank you very much for reaching out to the club.
Thank you for this very kind welcome.
Really appreciate it. We all know what amateurs we are now after watching this. I'll hand over to one of our committee members now, Vice President. who like
have
a bit of a chat with
you. Well, just got a little token. We give some of these things to our...
Thank you very much.
Friends, a little token.
Thanks.
And here's a memento.
Oh, wow.
Staying in Melbourne.
Oh, cool.
A shirt and a jacket.
Thank you very much.
Two shirts, one for him and one for
me. Cool. Well, you can be the best dressed woodworking company.
Thank you very much.
And people will say, what's that?
And you tell them Knox and District Woodworkers Club.
Never heard. How is this? No, I will make known Knox and Districts in the whole Switzerland and also in Italy. A lot of my students come from Italy because we are really, really near to Italy. So, well, yeah.
Teach you how to get dressed next time
you get. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Everyone's happy who's going to stay around and have a coffee. I'm sure Matthias would be happy to have a chat with you. Cool. Thanks all.
Thanks,
Bob. Oh, and if you could just send back the egg cups and the other bits and pieces, that's coming back here again.
Do you want to join me on Facebook?
Yes.
Down. Okay.